Hi friends, welcome back to my channel. I don't even know how to start an intro anymore. Hi, my name is Emma and let's talk spooky stuff. Welcome back. It has been a long time since I've done a sit-down video. Actually, I did a review a couple weeks ago, but it feels like a long time ago now, ever since I've been doing 12 Days of Christmas. If you don't know what 12 Days of Christmas is, it was very different, the format this year. I reviewed two movies every single video, and there were mystery movies that were wrapped up by my fiance and put underneath the tree. The best way to describe it is he does not like horror. He does not know horror. So it's very cringe. But if you do want to check that out, I'll leave the playlist down below because it is a fun time. And I know during the holiday season, there's a lot going on, but I do promise if you check out one of those videos, you'll be hooked to watch the rest. Because if you're as curious as me, it sucks you in, I tell you that. Every single day, I'm waiting to see what comes next. There's definitely a lot to unpack because I watched a lot this month, including a lot of TV shows, which was a surprise to me, but I will get into that. But first, a lot of people ask me how I watch so much content, especially geoblock content from around the world. And the answer is today's sponsor, Surfshark. Surfshark is a VPN, which stands for Virtual Private Network. Not only do Surfshark encrypt all of your information and protect your identity online, they also unlock content on streaming services that you may not have access to in your country. So for example, if I wanted to watch a horror movie that was only on Germany's Netflix, I could flick a switch and I'm in Germany and it works perfectly. I've been paying for Surfshark out of my own pocket for over a year now. I think it's the most user-friendly interface I've ever used for a VPN. Surfshark have a 30-day risk-free money-back guarantee. So if you're not happy with your service, within 30 days, you can ask for your money back and no questions asked. I highly recommend checking out Surfshark if you're looking for a VPN. And bonus, use my code word spooky for 83% off and 3 months extra for free. Thank you again to Surfshark for supporting my channel and sponsoring this video. Now, we have a lot to get into. First, I do want to say, this is just one of the things I got for Christmas and I thought I would share it here because I think it's really funny. I didn't get anything horror-based, but I got this beanie and I don't know if you can read it. It says, huge fan of space, both outer and personal, and that really suits my channel. So come winter, I will definitely be wearing this. I watched a lot of movies this month, especially to try and catch up with any hidden gems that I may not have seen of 2020 before I went into my top of 2020. And I tell you, I'm gonna have a lot of tops of 2020 videos come January, so get ready for that. But let's dive in. Let's start at the start of the month. I have not put in the 12 Days of Christmas I have watched just yet because it's a mystery. I probably will add them in later. I have them written down and my scores written down to add later. But I thought I would just keep it out of this video in case people were still curious and wanted to watch along for the mystery. I didn't really wanna destroy that. So let's start at the start of the month, which the first movie I watched was The Call. A lot of people going crazy about this movie. It is a South Korean horror movie, horror, adventure, fantasy, I would like to say. It's on Netflix and it is a remake of a Spanish film. I believe it's Spanish. And this film is about kind of hard to say. I'm sure it says, yeah, right there. A lot of people rated this really high. Look at that. The film is about a woman who makes contact with someone else who lived in the house 20 years earlier. I don't think that's a spoiler. It says it right there. But don't read the rest because it's a really cool, interesting tale about control and power, and I didn't expect that from it. I thought it was really well done. A lot of people are really obsessed with this movie, and I can understand why. I feel like it definitely is a hidden gem, and I'd recommend it to you all. I don't want to say too much about it because there's a lot of twists and turns, but the special effects in it are amazing. Next, I watched Paradise Hills, and this was another one on Netflix. This one's pretty crazy. It stars Emma Roberts, Awkwafina, Danielle McDonald, who is Australian. I love her. And I wasn't a big fan of it, to be honest. I know a couple of you had seen it in film festivals because after I posted it on Instagram, a lot of you contacted me and said, oh, I love that. But I feel like the look of it was what sold the whole story. It's like this fantasy kind of story about this girl who gets sent off to this island to correct herself pretty much. And they send all the bad kids there, but what's really going on? And it's almost like this dream, like a sucker punch kind of feel where it's like really dreamlike, not the same as Sucker Punch. It's interesting interesting in that regard. I think that the visuals are beautiful, and it's all about the setting and the costumes and design. But when you get past that, I didn't feel like it was anything that I hadn't seen before. Next, I watched Anything for Jackson. This was a huge release. This was a huge release on Shudder. This was on Shudder. And it is pretty crazy. A lot of my friends here on YouTube have done reviews on it. And Girly Gore, I recommend checking out her one. I'll link that down below. So this one is about grandparents who are grieving a loss and they decide to take matters into their own hands. Let's put that really loose. It's quite satanic. It's very magical. But I wasn't the biggest fan of it, to be honest. I mean, I thought it was okay. I gave it a 6, which I think is fine. But for me, it was super campy, but over the top. And you know me, I love satanic and all of that kind of stuff. But I don't know, it just didn't really work for me. I felt like it was so hyped up, and I was expecting something spectacular, but it really is more of an independent film, and not that anything's wrong with that. Just for the feedback I was hearing, this movie was meant to be the best thing I've ever seen. But and I think that's to my taste as well, is that I prefer more serious films. So this one, it was all right. It was worth a watch for sure, but I wouldn't say it was anything spectacular in my taste. In saying that, I just said I like more serious films, and then here's me with Killer Clowns from Outer Space giving it a 4.5. I have no excuse. I think maybe satanic and all of the themes that they cover in Anything for Jackson, I would have liked a more serious tone. It's really just personal preference. Killer Clowns from Outer Space is one of my favorite 80s films. I absolutely love this film. It's just adorable in every single sense. And yeah, I watched this with my patrons. We did a rewatch and I was very happy with it. I just love that film. If you haven't seen it, it is spectacular. The way it looks, the characters, just everything about it is just adorable in a really spooky way. I watched Come Play, which I was very surprised by this film. I hadn't heard much people talk about it since it came out, and it totally went under my radar. A lot of people only gave it like 2.5. You can see a couple of threes, but I actually really enjoyed it. I did not know when I saw I don't think I saw the trailer, because you know me, I don't watch trailers, but I did see some artwork for it. And with the title Come Play, I thought, you know, typical boogeyman after a kid. But there's a little bit of point of difference to this. The young boy is autistic, and he uses his phone to communicate, and this type of entity interferes with the way he communicates with his family, and I thought that was a really interesting look at it. Yeah, I would recommend this film. I thought it was much better and much more creepy than the name and the poster. Even look at the poster. It looks very stereotypical, but it's very different to what it portrays. Most of you probably have seen the trailer and probably know that, but I thought it was done in a really interesting way. It was kind of like Lights Out in a way. It was very creepy, but I could be alone there. I think I might be. The next film is Palm Springs. I don't want to say too much about this film because if you go in blind, it has a better effect, and I did not know what I was getting myself into, but I will say it is a really interesting comedy adventure, almost like love story. And I think it was done in, it presented itself in a really cool way. And we've seen this kind of storyline before, especially in horror movies, but I really liked the way, it kind of showed up out of the dark. It's about a group of people who are at a wedding in Palm Springs, and everything is just a little bit odd and off, and there's secrets. So vague. But I would really recommend it, especially if you want to watch something with your partner who maybe isn't into horror, or a family member. I would highly recommend it. I thought it was good. It's a good and interesting ride. I watched Shrek and Shrek 2. That was not my doing. I'm not a big Shrek fan. I'm really not. But I mean, it is what it is. I gave them 3, so it's not too bad. I watched Mimic, and this is the first time I've ever seen it. And I watched this because I was on Girly Gore. Again, I mentioned her channel before, but I'll link her down below. I was on her horror movie club where we talked about this film. This was such an interesting film, and we talk about, you know, the background of Del Toro. I'll put the live, because it was a live stream, down below, where we talk about this whole film, because if you watch the film and then watch that afterwards, you might find it interesting. I thought that this was so weird for a Del Toro film, and just weird in general. It's about this sickness that's taking over mainly in New York, and killing kids, and it's got to do with this bug, and then they bring in this hybrid bug to try and kill it, and then it's the after effects of this hybrid bug. It was very close to home at this time in general. But definitely worth a watch if you want to see Del Toro's earlier work. It's very interesting. But it has a lot of flaws. The film has a lot of flaws, but the history behind the flaws is quite interesting. It's got to do with the Weinsteins and all of this crazy stuff. So if you're interested in that, I would recommend it. I watched Black Bear, which is a film a lot of people have been talking about. This is Aubrey Plaza. Like, you've never seen her before. Actually, she does a lot of these cool roles, but this is a very experimental film. Again, one I don't want to give away too much because there is a big moment in it, and that's to say the least. I absolutely love this film, but I don't think it's for everyone. If you do like experimental film, if you like something a little bit different, the different way to tell a story, I think that that's probably what you'd be looking for. But it is about a woman. I'm trying not to go into it because I don't want to give away too much. It's about a woman who goes out into this almost like Airbnb cabin to write. She's a filmmaker and she wants to get these new ideas. And when she gets there, there's like this tension between the couple that are hosting her. And it's so thrilling and awkward. If you like that awkwardness, you'll love this film. I was dying watching it. I thought it was really effective. I watched Hosts, and this was a film a lot of people were telling me to watch. It was also a film that I mentioned, I think in my last recommended videos, I mentioned that there was a crazy dinner scene, but I hadn't seen the film. I really did not like it. A lot of people have been telling me to watch it and I was really bored out of my mind. It is a Christmas movie. It's on Christmas Eve. It says here, an innocent couple becomes host to a malicious entity. And I think that's probably the best way to describe it. There is an insane dinner table scene like everyone recommended or told me about. But the rest of it is kind of just all over the place. It's quite a messy film. It's quite independent. You can see a lot of people didn't really like it here. I think that it was just such a violent scene that a lot of people were a little bit vocal about that and not about the rest of it, but I probably wouldn't recommend it to you guys. I watched Homewrecker, which is a film that I spoke about many months ago in What's Coming to VOD, and I was so excited about this film. I thought it was so fun and different. Again, a very independent film. You can buy this one to rent on YouTube. That's what I did. And I loved it with my heart. It's so cute. The film is about a lonely middle-aged woman who meets this other woman and just kind of latches onto her, gets her into her house, and then doesn't let her go. Like, literally. It's a stalker film, and it's just so kooky and wild and just intense. And I totally take back about me liking serious films, because this is not a serious film at all. I feel like, obviously, with some storylines and points they make in films, it is fun to have campy films, but in some other ones, it's better to take it more seriously. But in this one, it is just so fun and campy, and I love it. And I would recommend it if you're into that kind of stalker film. But yeah, I don't think it's for everyone. It's just a fun little passion project almost. I watched Alone, which I was very surprised about. This is another film that a lot of people were talking about as their top of 2020. This is a survival horror, much like Curve. I've recommended Curve several times, which is a Blumhouse film. And this one was really cool. I believe I rented this one as well on YouTube, which is what I do a lot of the time with my VPN. And this one is about a woman who, yeah, is stalked by a man when she goes cross country by herself. I just thought it was a really well done survival film. It really gets into the elements. It's very gritty. It's very intense. Another film that took me by surprise and I did do a review on is The Wolf of Snow Hollow, Jim Cummings' film. I'm like obsessed with him now. I think he's so cool. But this film, I can definitely tell you it is in my top 10 of 2020. I have my top 20 on my computer right now and I'm dying because it's really hard to figure out what goes where. I keep moving them every day, but this is definitely up there. The Wolf of Snow Hollow is this amazing story, werewolf story, about this small town. And again, it treads the line of being campy and serious and having a serious message to a campy movie in such a cool and emotional way. I cried, I laughed, I love that film. I don't know. I feel like it got me. And my friend Jackie, she also watched it the other day. I just saw her on Instagram that she posted about watching it, that she loved it, but not everyone loved it. Again, all films that I feel really strongly about, usually it's because I have some kind of personal attachment with some perspective in the film. And I felt that for this. I just thought it was so clever. It really reminded me of Marc Duplass and the way he approaches filmmaking. So yeah, I highly recommend that. It's just something so different. Speaking of so different, Promising Young Woman. I did a review on this as well. So I'm not going to talk too much about it, but I will say people are starting to watch it now because it is out on cinemas now. I saw an early release and sorry, cinemas and VOD. But I do want to say a lot of people have come back, and this is going to be very controversial for me to say, but at this point in my channel, with a lot of you guys watching, I connect so much to you. And I feel like it's important to say this film isn't about man bashing, and I got a couple comments like that. It's about monster bashing. Like, I don't know how to say it more straightforward. The issues that films like this are trying to tackle, it's got to do with men who do bad things. And if you're not one of those people, you don't have anything to worry about. That's what I want to say. Don't take it as a personal attack. And if you do take it as a personal attack, it might mean something. Next, I watched Hillbilly. I watched this one on Netflix. This was based on a book, I believe. I didn't love the film. It's about three generations of abuse in Ohio, and about this guy who makes it by going to Yale. I don't know. I felt like it didn't come across probably as well as it did in the book. But Amy Adams is in it and she's amazing. Also, Glenn Close is kind of unrecognizable in this. So she was quite good, but I didn't love the film. After that, I rewatched Evil Dead, which is the remake from 2013. I think this is one of the best remakes of all time. It's so good. It's so bloody. And I did this with my patrons and a lot of them hadn't seen it yet and they were disturbed. It's really intense. I keep forgetting how intense it is every time I watch it. If you've been putting it off and you're looking for something intense, definitely check it out. There is so much blood. I then watch Jack Frost. I watched this for Does This Offend You? I did with Nightmare Maven. And I did that on my channel, so you can definitely check that out if you'd like to. And yeah, I'm not a big fan of the Jack Frost film. I think it's a bit meh, you know? But I get it. A lot of people like that kind of movie when it comes to Christmas time. I watched A Good Woman Is Hard to Find, and this is kind of a thriller that is on Shudder. It is about a woman. She's been put in a situation where, I don't know, everyone around her is so toxic and it's time for her to like stand up for herself, and she does so in the most badass way. It's hard to explain, but it's got a lot to do with her husband passed away and her trying to seek answers about his death. I thought it was quite good. I would recommend it to you guys for sure. I watched Christmas Evil, which this is a movie I reviewed a couple years ago, and I think I gave it 2.5 stars, but now I've given it 3.5 because when I watched it at the time, I had no idea how serious it was. And I mean, I do react and I know how serious it is when I watched it. But that first viewing, I was expecting it to be a campy horror movie. And then at the end, I was kind of shook. And rewatching it and realizing, like, knowing this time what it was more about definitely got me in the mood to watch it. It's about trauma, about Christmas and this child who sees something and it just affects his whole life. And it's such a sad, dramatic, intense movie. If you're up for something like that after Christmas, go for it. Otherwise, save it till next Christmas if you want to be depressed. The Prom. I watched The Prom and I wasn't a big fan. This is a Netflix musical and I think I probably did it to myself. I wasn't really in the mood for a musical and I just put it on the background. Meryl Streep, but of course, my girl, Nicole Kidman, who is my fave. If you didn't know, I absolutely love her. That's why I watched it. But it's an interesting story. It's about a girl who wants to take her girlfriend to prom. I say prom like this because I don't understand prom. It's very American to me. And they can't do it. And then this like Broadway musical cast comes to try and get some credit by coming and saving the day and trying to teach this small town about inclusivity. And they do so for the wrong reasons, but along the way, they learn something. It was fine for what it was, but it just, I guess, wasn't for me. But I gave it 2.5. I think it's like in the middle. Another film I gave 2.5 is Inheritance, which is such an interesting film. I do recommend you guys checking this one out. It's just the ending is so busted. It's about a woman who inherits a family secret that she must keep from everyone else. And it's so insane. But what's most insane about it is it's got Lily Collins and she is the main chick. but it's got Simon Pegg in it, and he is unrecognizable. Accent, the way he looks, the way he carries himself, I think it's such a good performance, just because I'm like looking at him going, that is Simon Pegg, right? But it's not. So that, you know, that's great. Good for him. But I think like the idea of the mystery is really interesting, and I was really into it because of that. But the ending is just very messy. So if you want a little bit of a mystery, definitely check it out. But just keep in mind that the end isn't the greatest. I then watched Home Alone. I watch Home Alone every single Christmas. It's our tradition. Home Alone is one of my favorite movies of all time. If you didn't know that, I'm sorry. I just love it so much, and I can't talk about it too much, otherwise I'll start crying. Claus, we watched this after Home Alone. We had some extra time on Christmas. This is an animation about Santa Claus and how he came to be. It was all right. I don't know why. We kind of like put on the background when we were like unwrapping presents and stuff. But yeah, not a big fan. We're also adults watching kids movies all the time, so don't know how much that says about us. I'm sure a lot of you guys do that as well. I finally got around to watching Warning Do Not Play, which is a South Korean horror movie about a cursed film. I actually thought this film was good with the atmosphere. It is like follows a filmmaker who's trying to get this idea, and hears about this cursed film that's made by a ghost, and she tries to track down where it's from. The film has a lot of twists and turns, but it has this creepy atmosphere where it's a lot of it, there's not much dialogue, and it's just her like walking through these abandoned buildings for like, you know, I don't know, like 20 minutes at a time. But I really liked it. It was such a creepy lead up, and I thought the atmosphere was so damning. But there was a lot of CGI and just weird computer generated moments that kind of took me out of it. I wish you saw like, I don't know, you know, shadows in the background would have scared me more than some of the stuff that came up. It also is highly inspired by the Blair Witch Project, and it does say this in the film. So if you're a fan of the Blair Witch, I would recommend checking it out just so you can kind of, I don't know, hear that perspective from a different side. But I didn't think it was amazing. Mostly the ending was quite confusing and really, yeah, forfeited a lot of the other scary moments. So I gave it a 2.5, but it is on Shudder in some countries. So check it out if that sounds interesting to you. The last film that I've watched up to today, which today I am filming this on the 28th of December. I know I still have a couple of days, but this is how I get in those films that that you guys don't know I watched and I talk about later. And you can follow me on Letterboxd. I put it all on here. I watched Hunter x Hunter, and I do want to talk about this film just really quickly. I don't want to give away too much. It is about this family who are living in the wilderness, and they're hunters, and this wolf is killing off animals around them, and they're terrified. So they go out to find the wolf. That's the easiest way of saying it. I don't want to say too much more, but I do want to say a lot of people were talking about this film on social media, and a lot of people were saying the word twist, that this film has a big twist. And I want you to go in knowing that the film doesn't have a big twist. It just has an epic conclusion, because I was waiting the entire film for it to have a big twist, and it doesn't. And it was very confusing to me, but I understand why people were hyping it up because of the ending. I do think it's a good film. It kept my attention. The characters were really well rounded, but it's quite a straightforward film. So just keep that in mind. I just don't want anyone to go in thinking that there's gonna be this huge reveal, because that's not really what happens. There's just a pretty, intense ending. I wish someone had told me that, because I was very confused watching the film. I'm like, wait, so does that happen? And I was trying to like pick apart what the twist would be, and I was completely off because I was worrying about that. But again, that's a me problem, I'm sure. Anyway, those plus the 12 Days of Christmas is everything I watched this month. Which if you do want to check out my last 12 Days of Christmas, I have a ranking as well. If you don't want to watch them all, I have a ranking of all of the ones I watched and what was the best. And I would recommend the top two, not so much the rest. But for this, I recommend watching Hunter x Hunter. I think that it's worth it for the epic scene. I'm sure you've seen Home Alone. Watch Warning Do Not Play if it sounds interesting to you. Christmas Evil might have missed the mark by now. A Good Woman is Hard to Find. I do recommend Evil Dead if you haven't seen it. Promising Young Woman, I do recommend that film. I think that it was really disturbing, jaw-dropping, intense stuff. The Wolf of Snow Hollow, of course, I highly recommend that one. Alone, I recommend. Homewrecker if you're into something campy and fun, kind of stalker single white female kind of stuff. Black Bear, if you like experimental thrillers. Mimic, I'm not sure if I'd recommend it to you guys. Come Play, I would recommend. Killer Clowns from Outer Space, if you've never seen that, definitely check it out. Anything for Jackson. I don't know. It's not really my thing, but it might be worth a spin for you. But definitely check out The Call, which is on Netflix. Okay, I have a few TV shows I want to talk about. I watched a lot of TV this month. First off, I watched The Ripper, which is a Netflix series about the Yorkshire Ripper. There's only 4 episodes, and I do feel like they keep some of the good information until the end of the second one. They really do keep you in the dark, and that's what happens with Netflix overproduced. I mean, looking flash and slick and have a storyline documentaries. They really want to keep you on the edge of your seat, so they do a cliffhanger at the end of every episode. But sometimes the information that you hear in some of the episodes doesn't make any sense until you know the full picture, if that makes sense. So I felt like it got better come the end of episode 2. So if you're hanging out and you're not too sure what's going on, just wait until the end of episode 2. I probably recommend that. I've been watching a lot of true crime lately, and that was one of the better TV shows, and it's only 4 episodes, so probably worth it. But an Australian series which hits very extremely close to home. In fact, I used to work with a guy who is featured as an interview person in this series, is After the Night. And this I thought was going to be about the serial killer Eric Edgar Cook, who was the last person who was hanged in Perth, Australia, where I live. But it turns out to be more about the police investigation and the wrongly accused person behind the murders and all that kind of stuff. And I just don't think it was produced in the best way. The way they put it together, I get they were trying to be clever and they were trying to involve especially the woman who found out and changed the investigation, but they did a weird kind of storytelling aspect with her, and I just didn't like it. This was on Stan in Australia. I'm not sure if it's showing in any other country, but yeah, something that was so close to home, I just wish it was produced in a better way. They were trying too hard to make it clever, and it seemed like the people who made the documentary may have been too involved in the story themselves, that they couldn't see it from the outside perspective and tell it a way that no one would understand the dynamic of the city at that time, if that makes sense. I finally started Lovecraft Country, which I know it's taken me forever. I wanted to wait until it was all out, and me and my partner wanted to watch it together. So I started that. I think we're halfway through now. It's so different to what I thought it was going to be like. And I do love that they have commented on a lot of, you know, the issues with Lovecraft and like kind of done a spin on that. I think that was really clever. And I thought it was obvious they were going to do that. The series really takes different aspect from Lovecraftian culture. I don't know, his books and his writing, and turns it into, it's almost like an anthology for me. I'm only halfway through. It's not an anthology. It has the same characters, but they definitely go through different stages. So they take different parts of stories he's written and form it into their own kind of way of interpreting them, if that make any sense. Very much fantasy, adventure, and horror all together. I'm not a huge fan of fantasy, but I see the appeal for this for sure. And the characters are super interesting. It's quite a good one. I'm very into it. And then the last TV show that I watched this month, and I just watched this yesterday, I binged the entire thing, and it was not hard to do, was The Undoing. Again, Nicole Kidman. This is another Nicole Kidman having problems, secrets in her family as a rich woman, which, I mean, they've been doing, Reese Witherspoon and Nicole Kidman have been doing these kind of series for a bit. They do say something. They always have like an underlying message in these TV shows. But this one was no different. It has Hugh Grant as like, oh my God, I can't even. He is so disgusting. I can't even in this. If you haven't seen it and you're a fan of Hugh Grant, don't watch it because it will ruin him for you. But it's about a woman who has this interaction with another woman in her, you know, like child school circle, and something's a little bit off. And from there, her whole life becomes undone. It was only 6 episodes long, so it was pretty easy to watch. I wouldn't say it's anything groundbreaking, but I was pretty entertained the whole time and definitely guessing the secrets, and I totally guessed wrong, which is quite funny. It's not as predictable as you think, which I thought was really cool. So that's everything from this month. What a long video. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you so much for supporting me. If you're new or if you've been around for a couple of years, thank you. This has been such a big year for my channel, from hosting an event for Universal Pictures Australia for The Invisible Man to becoming a Rotten Tomatoes critic. This has been such a big year for me, so thank you for being part of it. I love my small community and I love interacting with all of you, so thank you so much for being here. Coming up, I'm gonna have another What's Coming Out on VOD in January, and then of course, I'm gonna have so many top 10 lists. So make sure you bring your piece of paper and your pen, and I'll see you then. Stay safe and stay spooky. Bye, guys.